Hello to all subscriber members, and welcome to Practical Pain Management with Dr. Lee. Today, I will describe the ultrasound evaluation of the knee joint. How much depends on the ultrasound features when you find the pain generators in chronic knee pain? Ultrasound is highly effective in evaluating superficial structures like muscles, tendons, collateral ligaments, and joint recesses. However, assessing deeper structures, such as the meniscus and deep portions of the cruciate ligaments, is not enough. So, it is not wise to stick to the conventional viewpoint of ultrasound features when you evaluate chronic adult knee pain. All the popular conventional knee examination protocols are based on moderate to mild pain and middle age groups. You must modify the standard view to ultrasound application in chronic adult knee pain. I encountered challenges in understanding the pain generators of intractable adult knee pain when I tried to acquire information with the ultrasound. However, I have developed an in-depth understanding of intractable knee pain by accumulating evidence from an MRI study. I have reinterpreted the conventional belief of adult knee pain and ultrasound characters, correlating the location of the pain and simple passive knee joint range of motion tests. You might understand my viewpoint if you followed my adult knee series. I want to share a modified viewpoint toward knee pain. Ultrasound offers a more valuable tool for guiding injection procedures than a diagnostic tool in the knee joint. However, ultrasound has its advantages in diagnostic value, including interpreting the collapse of the meniscus, assessing the degree of bulging, evaluating the posterior portion of the anterior cruciate ligament through a posterior window, and observing protective forming marginal osteophyte. It adds value when combined with background knowledge such as pain location, pain intensity, and basic physical examination. So, let's begin with the basic ultrasound scanning techniques and add some tips to modify your viewpoint. Prepare to be amazed. Scanning technique. Knowledge of surface anatomy and bony landmarks is very useful in any part of the body. Correct transducer position concerning the underlying structure is key to achieving a good diagnostic image. Ultrasound examination of the knee will follow a sequence: anterior, medial, lateral, and posterior. Anterior evaluation. For evaluating the anterior knee, the patient should be seated on the edge of a bed with their legs hanging down. A knee flexion angle of approximately 70 to 90 degrees stretches the extensor mechanism and minimizes potential anisotropy of the quadriceps and patella tendons. When scanning in the sagittal plane superior to the patella, the focus is evaluating the distal quadriceps tendon and the suprapatellar recess. In the long axis, you can observe the multi-layered appearance of this tendon due to the close apposition and distal union of the three tendon layers arising from the quadriceps muscle. Be sure that enthesopathy of the insertion of the distal quadriceps tendon found in adults will be mostly asymptomatic and considered a normal aging process. I found several cases of symptomatic calcific tendinosis in the insertional area of the quadriceps tendon. Suprapatellar synovial recess is placed deep to the quadriceps tendon and suprapatellar fat pad and superficial to the femoral fat pad, and it may not always be visible as it is typically collapsed. A small amount of fluid in this recess is normal. The suprapatellar recess gives a standard injection target for the intra-articular injection. The prepatellar bursa is situated over the patella and the proximal patella tendon. Normally, this bursa is not visible on ultrasound. To detect a small amount of effusion, avoid applying excessive pressure with the transducer over this area, as this could displace the fluid from the ultrasound's field of view. The medial and lateral retinacula are placed on each side of the patella. They appear as bilayered structures indistinguishable from the underlying joint capsule. I typically do not examine these structures on a routine examination. Next, observe the infrapatellar tendon. In young athletes, such as weightlifters or fencing professionals, this tendon may exhibit overuse tears, commonly known as jumper's knee. Note that the lower pole of the patella has a V-shaped appearance, indicating that the patella tendon inserts not only on the apex, but also along the inferolateral and inferior medial edges of the bone. Deep to the patella tendon is Hofer's fat pad. I look for pathological deterioration of this triangular-shaped fat pad. On the surface of the tibia, the anterior cruciate ligament is located approximately posterior 1.5 cm from the anterior margin of the tibia. Check the deep infrapatellar bursa between the distal patellar tendon and the anterior aspect of the tibial epiphysis. Mild distension of this bursa, appearing as a small triangular hypoechoic area, is usually considered normal. Although I routinely inspect the infrapatellar bursa, I rarely find clinically significant infrapatellar bursitis. Medial evaluation. With the patient in the same position but with their leg externally rotated to expose the medial surface, I first orient the transducer in the coronal plane along the medial collateral ligament for examination. It is crucial to examine the entire length of the MCA, distinguishing between its superficial and deep layers. Dynamic scanning with valgus stress can enhance the assessment of the ligament's integrity. The meniscofemoral and meniscotibial ligaments, deep and thin, appear as compact, hyperechoic fibrillar structures extending from the meniscus to the femur and tibia. Next, I locate the triangularly sectioned medial meniscus and trace it from its anterior to the midhorn. I then stabilize the ultrasound probe to observe the meniscus bulging under dynamic varus and valgus stress. I categorize the integrity of the medial meniscus into four groups based on the degree of bulging and the approximation of the tibial and femoral bones during dynamic medialateral deviation stress tests. The four stages of medial meniscus integrity reflect the integrity of the ring-shaped structure. A higher degree of bulging and deterioration indicates a more advanced stage. I assess the patient's pain status based on the meniscal grade and the formation of protective marginal spurs. Lastly, I follow the profile of the MCA distally and then rotate the transducer forward to image the tendons of the pes anserinus complex in their long axis. Closely opposed tendons cannot be separated at their insertion on the tibia. While pes anserinus bursitis can be argued as a common cause of medial knee pain, I rarely find symptomatic cases of it in my practice. Therefore, exploring other potential sources of medial knee pain is important. Lateral evaluation. Imaging commences in the sagittal plane, just lateral to the patellar tendon. Begin by checking the iliotibial band along its long axis down to Gerdy's tubercle. The iliotibial tract is visible as a thin, flat, hyperechoic fibrillar structure. Be sure to search for any soft tissue lesions immediately superficial to the base of the lateral meniscus, such as a meniscal cyst. With the knee extended, place the lower edge of the probe on the fibular head, then slide its upper edge anteriorly until the lateral collateral ligament is visualized as elongated as possible in the ultrasound image. The distal aspect of the lateral collateral ligament may appear slightly thickened and heterogeneous near the proximal fibular attachment, potentially due to the adjacent biceps femoris tendon and anisotropy. While holding the distal aspect of the transducer steady, slide the proximal aspect posteriorly along the biceps femoris tendon to obtain a coronal image. This proximal imaging should include a careful evaluation of the myotendinous junction of the two heads of the biceps femoris muscle, a common site of sports-related tears. Additionally, evaluate the proximal tibiofibular joint for joint effusion and para-articular ganglia using axial and coronal ultrasound images taken over the anterior aspect of the fibular head. While musculoskeletal specialists commonly consider iliotibial band syndrome for lateral knee pain, I have not found it to be a significant cause of lateral knee pain. The lateral part of the knee comprises multiple layers, and the lateral meniscus, being deeper than the medial meniscus, presents a lower chance of detecting lateral meniscal tears with ultrasound than the medial meniscus. Posterior evaluation. The patient should lie prone with an extended knee to evaluate the posterior knee. Begin the posterior knee evaluation by locating the echogenic posterior capsule through longitudinal scanning. From there, trace the posterior triangular low echo areas corresponding to the posterior cruciate ligament and the posterior portion of the anterior cruciate ligament. Pathologies of the anterior cruciate ligament are common in adults experiencing knee pain during flexion and extension. Tears at the posterior root of the medial or lateral meniscus are common causes of severe knee pain, particularly during flexion. Unfortunately, ultrasound diagnosis of these root tears is not typically feasible. However, you can suspect such tears if the patient exhibits painful flexion limitation and fluid accumulation in the posterior fat pad. Next, focus on the semimembranosus tendon and the adjacent bursal space. When scanning the posteromedial knee in transverse planes, you can identify the sartorius, gracilis tendon, and semitendinosus tendon behind the semimembranosus tendon. The semimembranosus gastrocnemius bursa is visualized using axial planes positioned between the semimembranosus tendon medially and the medial head of the gastrocnemius laterally. Also, look for the presence of a Baker's cyst. In the popliteal fossa, sweep the transducer up and down to demonstrate the popliteal neurovascular bundle, including the popliteal artery, vein, and tibial nerve. This tracing is particularly important during ultrasound-guided injections in the posterior fossa, mainly targeting the posterior fat pad. If you are unfamiliar with posterior injection, please watch the adult knee series. It will show the importance of the posterior injection in controlling intractable knee pain. Continue sliding the ultrasound probe laterally to examine the biceps, popliteus muscle, and tendon. The common peroneal nerve can be identified on the posteromedial aspect of the biceps femoris by its hypoechoic nerve bundles surrounded by hyperechoic structures. Follow the common peroneal nerve to the neck of the fibula bone. Thank you for watching. I hope this session helped you understand the basic ultrasound strategy for evaluating knee pain. I look forward to sharing more in our upcoming videos.